Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Restoring What Was Lost by Barbara Hinske. Narrated by Dina Pearlman. Chapter 1. Maggie Martin pushed her disheveled chestnut hair off her face and wound her way through the crowd of police officers congregating on the steps of Highpointe College Library. As president of Highpointe, she was given access that the officers would have denied to anyone else. Police cruisers idled along the drive, in front of the imposing Romanesque facade of the library, their flashing red lights slicing across the brick and glinting off the dark glass of the arched windows before disappearing into the night. The low rumble of their engines underscored the urgency of the scene. She approached Dean Anthony Plume as he stepped off the bottom step. The English literature professor staggered, his trim gray hair in uncharacteristic disarray. She caught his arm, steadying him. He stared at the retreating taillights of the ambulance that had just departed. "What happened?" Maggie asked. Anthony faced her. "It's all my fault," he said, his eyes wild and expression distorted. "He almost killed her." Maggie recoiled and tightened her grip on his arm. "Who?" "Sunday Sloan." A moan escaped his lips. "I was almost too late."
"What are you talking about?"
"That man, the one they took away in the ambulance. He was trying to kill her." Still bewildered, Maggie looked into Anthony's eyes.
"Why would someone want to kill one of our librarians?"
Anthony brought his hands to his temples and swayed on his feet.
"Let's get you someplace where you can sit down."
She touched his shoulder and he winced. "You're hurt, aren't you?" Maggie began to lead Anthony to a low stone wall at the base of the steps when an officer intercepted them.
"We'd like to take your statement, sir. Can you come to the station?"
"He's hurt," Maggie said. "He needs medical attention."
"I'm fine," Anthony said to the officer and spun to Maggie. "I'm responsible for all of this." His voice cracked and his words tumbled out. "I'm a gambler and got in over my head. I started stealing rare books from the collection that Hector Martin left the college library when he died."
Maggie brought her hand to her heart.
Her life was intersecting with Hector Martin's again. She'd inherited Rosemont from her late husband, Paul Martin, who was one of Hector's heirs. Moving to Rosemont when Paul died had dramatically changed the trajectory of her life. Anthony paused to draw a deep breath.
"It was supposed to be the perfect crime. Nobody was going to notice they were missing, and nobody was supposed to get hurt. But I sold them to a man named Nigel Blythe, the man who just tried to kill Sunday."
The officer stepped forward.
"You need to come with me."
Maggie addressed Anthony.
"This is very serious. You shouldn't say anything else until you've hired an attorney."
"I don't care. I want to tell you everything."
He looked at Maggie.
"You trusted me and I betrayed that trust. I'm so sorry."
He rattled on.
"Nigel killed Hazel Harrington when she was in charge of the rare books. She was getting suspicious about the thefts. He was here to do the same to Sunday. I had to stop him."
Maggie gasped. The officer clutched Anthony's right arm.
"You can tell us all about it at the station."
He stepped forward, bringing Anthony with him. Anthony raised his voice.
"He was going to kill Sunday by pushing her off the second floor landing. I couldn't let that happen."
A sob escaped his throat.
"Too many people have suffered on account of me."
"Don't say anything else, Anthony," Maggie said, following them. "Wait for your lawyer."
"I'm done waiting. For once in my life, I'm going to do the right thing and tell the truth."
The officer opened the back door of a police cruiser and placed his hand on the top of Anthony's head as the professor lowered himself into the seat. John Allen gave his wife's hand a reassuring squeeze as he pulled into the parking lot of police headquarters. A line of police cruisers idled in front of them. He and Maggie watched as Anthony was removed from the back seat of one of the vehicles and led into the building. Maggie turned to her husband.
"You can let me off here."
What are you talking about? I'm going in with you. She put her hand on his arm.
I'll probably be here all night. You've got a full schedule of surgeries in the morning.
John opened his mouth to protest. Maggie raised her hand to stop him.
I can't tell you how much I appreciate your coming with me to the library, John. But we can't have Westbury's favorite veterinarian too tired to function at the top of his game.
I'll be fine on my own. She pointed toward the front of the building where a young man and woman were climbing the steps to the entrance.
Josh and Sunday are here. I'll get a ride home with Josh.
John turned to his beloved wife. I guess you're right. I have to get some sleep. My schedule tomorrow is packed.
You need to hire another vet. Your workload is off the charts.
I know. He sighed heavily. I'm working on it. Go ahead, but keep me posted. And don't go straight to the college when you're done here. You need some sleep. Highpointe can do without its president for the morning.
I promise, Maggie said, leaning over to kiss his cheek.
Text me when you get home if I've already left for the animal hospital.
Of course, she said as she got out of the car.
She made her way through the tangle of police cars and entered the utilitarian slump block building, large block letters stamped in stone dominating the double glass doors. Westbury Police Department. Josh and Sunday were huddled together along the wall just inside the entrance. Maggie's efficient administrative assistant had a cell phone to his ear. She'd be sad to see Josh Newlon leave when he completed his graduate studies in college administration. Maggie joined them.
They want to question me, Sunday said, and Josh insists that I have a lawyer with me when I talk to them.
She shifted her weight from foot to foot, swaying unsteadily.
He was going to kill me. He fell off the landing, and
Josh is absolutely right. You shouldn't be talking to us either.
You don't think I had anything to do with this, do you?
I most certainly don't. We haven't worked together for very long, but I don't think my rare book librarian is involved in anything criminal. Still, you shouldn't say anything to anyone without your attorney being present. She patted Sunday's hand reassuringly. My daughter is a lawyer, and she'd tell you the same thing.
That's who he's calling. Susan. She helped him find his birth mother.
I remember. Susan arranged the meeting between Josh and Lila. Josh rested his tall, athletic frame against the wall and stabbed at his phone screen to end the call. Susan said she'd be here in half an hour.
Good, Maggie said.
Sunday sagged against the wall and put her hands to her head.
I can't believe what just happened.
Chief Andy Thomas approached them. Ms. Sloan? Sunday nodded. We'd like to take your statement.
My lawyer will be here soon, she said. Susan Scanlon, I'd like to wait for her.
That's fine. Let me put you in a private room until she gets here. Anthony Plume has provided a detailed statement. We just want to corroborate what he said. He regarded her carefully. Looks like you need to sit down. I'll get you some water, too.
That'd be nice.
She pushed herself away from the wall. Just Ms. Sloan, the chief said when Josh began to follow her. You can stay out here, with Maggie.
Can't I sit with her? Josh asked.
It's okay, Sunday said. I'll be fine. You should go home and get some sleep.
I'm not leaving here without you.
I can use your help while we're waiting for Sunday, Maggie said. She glanced at Chief Thomas and raised an eyebrow. I suspect that Dean Plume won't be available to teach his classes tomorrow.
I can't comment on an ongoing investigation, but that's a safe assumption for now and for the foreseeable future.
He put his hand on Sunday's shoulder and steered her to the steel door that separated the waiting room from the interior of the police station. He waved his key card over the keypad, the door lock clicked open, and he escorted Sunday inside and out of view.
Josh pointed to a row of molded plastic chairs where he and Maggie each took a seat.
Who was that other guy who walked out of the library? The one you were talking to? An officer put him in a police car pretty fast. I didn't get a look at him. What'd you say his name was?
Anthony Plume.
Dean of English Literature?
Maggie nodded.
The guy you put on the Friends of the Library Committee?
That's the one.
Do you think he was part of whatever was going on with the guy that they took out on the stretcher?
I'm afraid so.
Well, the police aren't treating him like the hero who saved the day.
Maggie shrugged. I don't know what happened in there, but I do know we've got to cover Anthony's classes. She pointed to Josh's phone. Can you pull up the school calendar on that thing so we can see if he's got anything scheduled for tomorrow?
Josh's fingers began flying across the screen. Yep, a second-level class at 11 o'clock.
Does he have a graduate assistant?
Josh scrolled down on his screen and nodded.
Can you find contact information for this grad student?
Her college email is linked on the screen.
Great. Email this.
Dean Plume will be unable to attend his 11 o'clock class. Please conduct the class and contact President Martin's office for further instructions. Josh arched his brows at Maggie. This is going to get the rumor mill going.
I think the morning news will accomplish that. In spades.
Josh typed the email and tapped send. Done.
What about the rest of the week?
He's got a bunch of committee meetings, all within the department. I think he spent most of his time on administrative duties.
We've lucked out there. It'll make his absence easier to work around.
You don't think he'll be questioned and released?
Maggie bit her lip. No. I think Dean Anthony Plume won't be returning to Highpointe.
What else can I do to help?
Set up a meeting between me and the chairs of the English department for late tomorrow afternoon.
In your office?
Maggie nodded as Susan pushed open the door to the waiting room, allowing a blast of frigid air to precede her. She adjusted her oversized, dark-rimmed glasses on the bridge of her nose. Josh and Maggie leaped to their feet.
Mom, what are you doing here?
Susan blurted, unwinding a scarf and allowing her thick blonde hair to cascade around her shoulders. She lifted a hand.
Never mind. Of course you'd be here. Where's Sunday?
They put her in a room to wait for you. She was pretty shaken up.
I tell you both to go home, that it'll be a long night and I'll call you when I've got information to share, but I suspect that neither of you would listen to me.
Maggie and Josh nodded in unison.
Let me get in there and do my job.
She looked into Josh's eyes and her expression softened.
Don't worry. You did the right thing by calling me. We'll get this sorted out.
Susan walked to the receptionist seated behind bulletproof glass and proffered her credentials before being admitted into the station. Chapter 2. Maggie paced in front of a window overlooking the police headquarters parking lot. Three cars came around the side of the building. She recognized Chief Thomas's car in the lead, his lights flashing as his vehicle entered the street and picked up speed.
I wonder where they're going, she said to Josh.
He rose to join her at the window. The inner door to the waiting room opened, and Susan and Sunday walked out.
Nigel Blythe is out of surgery and has regained consciousness, Susan said. The chief is on his way to question him.
Makes sense, Maggie said. Josh held out his arms to Sunday and she sank into them.
Are you all right?
Yes,
Sunday mumbled against his shoulder.
Anthony confessed to everything.
Sunday's account of what happened in there corroborated his statement, Susan said.
Eyes wide, Maggie and Josh looked at Susan.
Reader's Digest version. Nigel Blythe realizes Sunday has discovered that Highpointe's stolen books are being sold out of Blythe Rare Books, his bookshop in London. So, Blythe orders Anthony, who's been selling him the rare books to cover his gambling debts, to kill Sunday. When Anthony won't do it, Blythe arrives to do the deed himself. But what does Anthony do? He follows Sunday and foils a hitman's attempt to run her down in a parking lot by putting his own car in harm's way, sending him straight to the hospital with a concussion. "Anthony saved my life. Twice today," Sunday interjected. Susan continued. Anthony knows Blythe won't stop, so he leaves the hospital against doctor's orders and takes a cab to the library. The only cars in the lot are Sunday's and Blythe's, and the library is locked. So Anthony breaks in through a basement window and runs upstairs to find Sunday struggling with Blythe on the second-story landing. Anthony attacks Blythe, who tries to push him over the railing. Susan paused and looked at Sunday. "I grabbed the bust of Alfred Lord Tennyson from that niche on the landing and hit him on the back. I wanted to break his grip on Anthony." Sunday raised both hands and splayed her fingers. "Nigel released Anthony but lost his footing. The landing was coated with something slippery. It all happened so fast. One minute he was sliding toward the railing, his arms flailing, trying to regain his balance, and the next he was tumbling over it and onto the marble floor below." She shuddered, and Josh put his arms around her again. "You did the only thing you could do," Susan said. "Blythe intended to kill you both. The police are satisfied that you acted in self-defense."
"She's not being charged with anything?" Josh asked.
"No, nothing at all," Susan replied. Maggie turned to Josh and Sunday.
"Why don't you both go home and try to rest?
The library is a crime scene, and the police will have it cordoned off at least through tomorrow," Susan said.
"I'll send out a college-wide email that the library will be closed until further notice. I'll also call Lila and ask her to post a sign on the doors before it opens," Josh said.
"Good thinking." "Thank you," Maggie said. "I'll walk you to your car," Susan said to Maggie.
"John dropped me off," Maggie replied.
"Then I'll give you a ride home. I want to talk to you about the fallout that you're sure to face over this."
"What do you mean?" Sunday asked. "The vast majority of thefts happened years before either President Martin or I were on campus."
"I understand," Susan said. "But you were here when they were discovered."
Maggie put her hands on her temples. "That's exactly how these things work. And I was the one who appointed Anthony to the Friends of the Library Committee." She shook her head. "This is going to be a nightmare."
"I've got some ideas for how to handle the situation," Susan said.
"It'll be just like the fallout from the fraud and corruption scandal at Town Hall," Maggie moaned.
"Not this time," Susan said. "You've got people who will have your back."
She moved to the entrance. "The best thing we can all do right now is get some sleep. All hell is going to break loose soon enough."
Susan stepped into the house from the garage, took off her shoes, and laid her purse on the kitchen counter. She looked at the digital clock on the wall oven. 4:15. With any luck, she'd be able to get a couple of hours sleep before her day exploded into activity. She was padding her way quietly across the kitchen when the baby monitor crackled. She hesitated. "Julia, please don't be awake," she thought. "I'm exhausted." Everything was quiet. Julia should be asleep for another hour at least. Despite her fatigue and better judgment, Susan slowly pushed open the door to her daughter's room and moved noiselessly to the side of the crib. Cooper was curled nose to tail under the crib in his usual spot. The golden retriever opened an eye as she approached and thumped his tail once. Susan stared at her daughter's peaceful form, snug in her footed flannel onesie. She was stepping back from the crib when Julia rolled over and opened her eyes wide. She stared at her mother, then pushed herself into a sitting position. A smile lit Julia's face.
"No! Now I'll never get back to sleep."
Susan picked up her daughter and gave her a quick hug.
"It's not time to get up yet," Susan whispered. She laid Julia back in the crib. Why, oh why, had she disturbed her? Julia popped back up. No, sweetheart. Time to go back to sleep.
Susan walked to the door. Cooper got to his feet and stretched, keeping his eyes trained on Susan. Julia began to whimper. When Susan disappeared from view, Julia began to wail. Susan paused in the hallway. Please stop, she thought. Julia's cries became louder and more insistent. Susan sighed heavily. She had awakened Julia and shouldn't let the baby's crying disturb her husband. Running Westbury's busiest orthopedic surgical practice, Dr. Aaron Scanlon was chronically sleep-deprived. She returned to her daughter's room. Julia's cries filled the space. Susan reached for her.
I'll take her.
Susan jumped at the voice that had snuck in behind her.
Sorry,
Aaron said. You've been gone way longer than expected. I don't have to be at work until 10. Go back to bed and I'll take care of Julia this morning.
Really?
Susan covered her mouth to stifle a yawn. Aaron picked up the now quiet Julia. He leaned over and kissed his wife.
I've never known you to have a middle-of-the-night emergency, he said. What happened?
You won't believe it, Susan said. Come with me while I get out of these clothes and I'll fill you in.
Cooper followed, stretching out at the foot of their bed. Aaron rubbed Julia's back while Susan recounted the events of the evening.
That's incredible. Who would have thought this rural Midwestern town would be so full of intrigue?
That's for sure, Susan said, throwing back the covers and getting into bed. It's always interesting, though. And once again, my mother seems to be in the middle of it all.
Surely this won't affect her much, will it? Other than finding someone to take Plume's place?
Don't count on that, Susan said.
Cooper rested his nose on the side of the bed. Susan patted the spot next to her, and he launched his 85-pound body onto the bed.
The Board of Trustees will come under tremendous scrutiny, and they'll be looking for someone to blame, Susan said. It's usually the college president.
That's not fair. This wasn't Maggie's fault.
I'm afraid that won't matter.
Susan settled into her pillow.
Is there anything you can do about it? Can Alex help?
Susan pushed herself onto her elbows. She regarded her husband.
You know, I think your brother could be tremendously helpful. That's a great idea.
Alex knows everybody in town from his days as a prosecutor, and now as Westbury's mayor. He'll do anything for your mom.
There are others, too.
Like?
Frank Haynes, Tim Knudsen,
just for starters.
Susan threw her legs over the side of the bed.
What are you doing? I thought you were going back to bed.
Not anymore, I'm not. I'm wide awake now.
What can I do to help?
Can you make coffee? I'll send some emails, organize talking points, then hit the phone.
It's way too early to call anyone.
You're right. I'll wait until 6 to call Alex. He's an early riser.
She shoved her feet into her slippers.
He'll probably be done with his morning run by then.
You're sure things will get as bad as all that for Maggie? You're not overreacting?
Susan patted her thigh and Cooper reluctantly abandoned his spot on the bed. She kissed her daughter as she slipped by Julia and Aaron.
I wish I were. Trust me. This is going to be a disaster.
Chapter 3. Lila Kershaw peered through her windshield at the tidy bungalow. A cheerful twig wreath hung on the dark gray front door, which was flanked by vibrant orange pots. In a few weeks, spring would be upon them, and she knew Sunday would fill them with vibrant annuals. Lila checked her reflection in her rearview mirror. Her shoulder-length auburn hair was streaked with gray. She had considered visiting her salon to cover the gray, but she liked what she saw in the mirror, a woman comfortable in her mid-50s, still fit and trim. She took a steadying breath. Josh's call about the events at the library last night had startled her. Why would anyone want to kill Sunday?
She and the young librarian had worked together since Sunday had come to the library. They'd formed an easy camaraderie on Sunday's first day that had deepened into a close friendship over the years. Now that Sunday and Josh were seeing each other, Lila couldn't be happier. She blinked rapidly as emotion welled up in her. Lila still couldn't believe her great fortune in reuniting with the son she had given up for adoption, and that this son was actually Josh Newlon. They'd become friends while taking a painting class together before they learned they were mother and son. Her life was overflowing with joy, and Lila wasn't going to let anything derail that. She picked up her cell phone from the passenger seat and hovered over the redial button. She'd been trying to reach Sunday since she'd hung up with Josh. When Sunday hadn't picked up, she'd gotten worried and driven over. She unbuckled her seatbelt and got out of the car. She made her way up the driveway that ran along the house to the detached garage, searching for any movement or light peeking through the closed plantation shutters. Was she being ridiculous? It was so early. Maybe Sunday was asleep. Lila didn't want to wake her friend. The house was dark. She was heading back to her car when, through the shutter slats of a rear window, she saw Sunday's silhouette moving in a darkened room. Lila stepped toward the window, raised her hand, and waved. Sunday opened the shutter, and the two women stood looking at each other through the glass. Sunday pulled the crocheted throw that hung from her shoulders tighter around herself and motioned to the back of the house with her head. Lila nodded and began walking. Sunday waited in the open driveway. She stepped aside and motioned for Lila to follow her into her kitchen. Lila laid a gentle hand on Sunday's back. The young woman turned to her. Lila threw her arms wide, and Sunday stepped into them, gasping and sobbing. Lila held her friend in a strong embrace until Sunday's breathing calmed. Sunday pulled back and wiped her eyes with both hands. "Sorry about that," she said in a shaky voice. "Nonsense," Lila said. "You've got nothing to be sorry about. I'd be doing the same thing in your shoes."
"Josh told you?"
Lila nodded. "As much as he knew."
"I'd like to tell you everything," Sunday said, beginning to tremble again. "But I can't right now. I just can't."
"Of course not," Lila said. "There's time for all of that later."
"Or you never have to tell me, for that matter. I'm here because I'm worried about you and didn't want you to be alone. I tried to call, but you didn't pick up, so I decided to come and check on you."
Sunday pushed her hair out of her eyes.
"My phone must be in my purse. I dropped it by the front door when I got home and went upstairs to change into my pajamas."
She looked down at the black flannel pants with comical penguins marching across the fabric.
"I actually thought I was going to get some sleep."
"Did you?"
"I crawled into bed, but my mind kept replaying everything in a loop as soon as I shut my eyes. It was like I was watching a horror film on a continuous feed, and I was at the center of it all."
Lila led Sunday to the kitchen table and urged her into a chair. "I can only imagine how terrifying that was."
"I gave up on sleep and came downstairs. I thought I'd go back to bed once it was light out."
Her voice cracked.
"Maybe it wouldn't be so scary then."
"That's an idea." Lila looked at the counter. Eggs, bread, and butter were laid out next to the stove.
"Are you hungry?"
Sunday shrugged.
"I thought if I ate something, it might help me sleep."
"Good plan. Let me scramble these eggs and make you some toast."
"Have you had breakfast?" Sunday asked.
She looked at the clock on the stove.
"It's not even 6. Make yourself some, too. Join me."
"I will," Lila said, lighting the burner under the pan and cracking 4 eggs into it. "We'll eat, and then you can try to get some sleep. I'll stay here until you wake up."
"You don't have to do that. I'm not a baby. I'll be fine."
"You're not being a baby. You've suffered a serious trauma." She placed bread into the toaster and pushed the lever down. "I think you should see a counselor to help you cope with what's happened."
Sunday lowered her gaze to her hands in her lap.
I don't know about that.
Lila gave the eggs a final stir and slid the pan off the hot burner. You can decide all of that later, after you've slept. She buttered 4 thick slices of sourdough bread and placed them and the fluffy eggs onto 2 plates. She brought them to the table and took a seat opposite Sunday.
Eat what you can, Lila said.
Sunday tried and failed to smile. She picked up her fork.
You'll need to go to work when we're done.
Nope, the library's closed today for obvious reasons. I've got my laptop in the car and I'm going to work remotely. She tapped the tabletop. From right here, I'll stay all day so you can get some sleep. Sunday opened her mouth to protest.
Or we can pack you up and you can come to my house, Lila continued, wherever you feel better.
Sunday took a bite of her toast.
You're the best friend anyone could ever have.
Lila beamed. She felt the same way about Sunday and knew that her son was smitten with this lovely woman. Hopefully one day, Sunday would be her daughter-in-law.
Chapter 4
Mommy can't take us to school.
5.5-year-old Nicole Nash found Frank in his home office placing orders for supplies for Haynes Enterprises, the fast food franchise holding company he owned and now ran with the help of his wife, Loretta.
I know, sweetheart, Frank said. Marissa said she'd help you with your breakfast and get you dressed.
He didn't take his eyes from the screen. I need to get this order placed and then I'll drive the 3 of you to school. Nicole didn't move away.
Why is Mommy so sick? She asked in a small voice. Is she dying?
Frank swiveled his chair to face her, opening his arms to her.
Of course not. Mommy's got morning sickness is all. She'll be fine. Probably in a few weeks.
Nicole threw her arms around the stepfather she adored.
The baby's making Mommy sick? Is the baby sick too?
The baby is fine, Frank said. Your mother and I are going to the doctor at the end of the week for a special test called an ultrasound. We'll bring home pictures of what your brother or sister looks like in Mommy's tummy. Would you like that?
Nicole moved her head up and down against his shoulder.
Nicole,
Marissa called from the hallway.
She's in here with me, Frank called back.
Marissa appeared in the doorway.
Come on, Nicole. You've got 10 minutes to eat and get your clothes on. I'm in high school now and I can't be late.
She made a sweeping motion toward the door.
Get going. You don't have to yell at me, Nicole said.
I'll drop you off first, Marissa. If anyone's going to be late, it'll be her, Frank said as Nicole scampered away. She's worried about your mother.
I know, Marissa said. Morning sickness doesn't sound like it's any fun. Mom's fine, though, isn't she?
Completely.
I'll round up Sean and we'll be ready to go.
You've been a tremendous help through all of this, Marissa. Your mom and I appreciate it more than we can say.
Marissa blushed.
Thanks. I'll let you finish so we can get out of here.
Chapter 5
Maggie looked at the 6 faces turned to her and felt a surge of warmth. The senior members of the English department who crowded around the small conference table in her office were a capable and committed lot. She leaned forward in her chair.
I can't tell you how impressed I am that you've already made a plan to cover Dean Plume's absence.
The graduate student you emailed last night has been in several of my classes and contacted me early this morning, said a gray-haired man with a ruddy complexion. Anthony's arrest was also all over the news this morning. By the time we got in, we all knew that we'd have to divvy up his work to keep the department running, a woman said. We don't want any students or the reputation of the department to be affected.
Maggie lifted the stack of papers the woman had handed to her when the group arrived.
When did you have time to get all of this decided, much less put down on paper?
We canceled our lunch plans and met to work this out. By the time we had to break it too, we'd settled on everything.
Maggie's tired smile radiated around the room.
As I said, I'm most impressed and grateful that you've taken this on.
The man seated to her right lifted the lid from the cut glass candy dish in the middle of the table. He helped himself to a piece of Werther's original candy and passed the dish to the person next to him.
We figured you'd be busy with other aspects of whatever this is, another woman said. I'm sorry I can't say more, Maggie began when she was interrupted by a knock on the door.
Her administrative assistant pushed the door opening without waiting for an invitation. Excuse me, President Martin, he said. Maggie drew her brows together. Josh never addressed her by her title. We're almost through. An imposing man in an impeccable suit pushed past Josh. Maggie got to her feet. The chairman of the Board of Trustees ignored the others and spoke directly to Maggie.
The trustees would like a word with you. Now.
Maggie inwardly bristled. Who did he think he was, barging in on her like this, treating her like a truant child? She calmly smoothed her skirt. The members of the English department remained motionless.
How nice to see you.
Certainly. She turned to Josh. Would you show the trustees to our boardroom? And would you mind making coffee? Josh nodded. The members of the department began to gather their things.
We're almost done with our meeting, Maggie said to the trustee in clipped tones. I'll be with you in a few minutes.
The trustee turned on his heel and strode out of the room. Josh followed in his wake.
We can finish up later, said one of the professors. I don't think you should keep them waiting, said one of the women, giving Maggie a worried look. As I said, I'll be with them when we are finished here. Your time is valuable, especially now that you're all taking on more responsibilities.
She pointed to the papers.
I think you've considered everything. I approve of your plan. Don't hesitate to contact me if issues arise as you begin to implement this. I don't feel the need to meddle in the way you run your department, but I want to help if you need me.
Maggie stepped to the door of her office and shook every hand as the professors filed out of her office. She inhaled slowly, then went to her desk. She knew from her late husband's tenure as president of Windsor College, an impromptu visit from the Board of Trustees was never good news. Pulling her lipstick out of her desk drawer, she swiped on a fresh dash of color and checked her hair in her hand mirror. She might be exhausted from her sleepless night, but she didn't need to look it. Josh looked up to find Maggie striding toward his desk.
They're in there.
He nodded his head toward a room down the hall.
How many of them?
9.
That's all of the trustees. She raised her eyebrows. They all made time to come here. On such short notice?
Josh nodded.
What's the tone in the room?
He shifted uncomfortably in his chair and opened his mouth to speak.
Never mind. I can guess.
She sighed heavily. Susan warned me. She glanced at the bleak expression on Josh's face. Don't worry about me. I've been through worse, especially as mayor of Westbury. I put coffee and water in the room. Do you think you'll need anything else?
No, thank you. That should do it. It's after 5. You can leave now.
He shook his head. If it's all the same, I'm staying right here until they leave.
You don't have to do that. I'm sure you didn't get any more sleep last night than I did. Go on, get out of here. I can handle this on my own.
Maggie held her head high as she walked to the conference room. Josh watched the door close behind Maggie before he picked up his cell phone and scrolled to Susan's number. She picked up on the third ring.
You just caught me. I was about to pack it in for the day. What's going on?
I think the you-know-what has hit the fan, just like you predicted.
Why do you say that?
The entire Board of Trustees just showed up here, unannounced, and demanded to see your mom.
Susan sucked in her breath.
You're right. That's not good.
What did Mom do?
She was in the middle of a meeting with members of the English department. The chairman of the board barged right in and demanded to see her. She told him she'd be with him when she was done.
Susan chuckled.
Good for her. She's not one to let herself be bullied.
You should have seen his face when he left her office after being told to wait. Josh lowered his voice. Furious. I think she made things worse for herself.
Don't worry about my mom. She knows how to handle herself.
She's in there with them now. I just thought you'd want to know.
The line remained silent.
Susan?
I'm here, she said. Just thinking. Are you heading home now?
No. I'm going to stay until they leave, in case Maggie needs me for anything.
Thank you, Josh. That's very thoughtful of you. I think I'll swing by, too. See you soon.
Chapter 6.
Sean heard a familiar woof-woof coming from the end of the hallway on his right. The kennels of Forever Friends, Westbury's no-kill animal shelter, were at the other end of the building. It must be Dodger. He headed down the hall in search of the dog and his master.
Hey, David, Sean said to the tall, lanky teen.
Sean knelt to greet Dodger, the mid-sized mixed breed who was David Wheeler's constant companion. David had adopted the one-eyed dog from Forever Friends after his father's jailhouse suicide. William Wheeler's convictions for fraud and embezzlement while he was mayor of Westbury had demoralized David. His father's death had devastated him. The grief-stricken teen had landed in the juvenile court system after stealing from his high school. Glenn Vaughn, his court-appointed mentor, had been a godsend. The older man not only recognized the boy's pain, but also his potential, and wanted to help. Glenn was the one who insisted that David get a dog. As often happens with rescue dogs, it was hard to say who saved whom. Dodger brought promise and happiness back into David's life, and David brought safety and tenderness to the abused strays. Together, they learned to trust again and discovered the joys of serving others as a therapy dog team. Dodger touched his cold nose to Sean's cheek and swiped his tongue over the boy's ear. Sean laughed and reached in his pocket for a dog treat.
Daisy won't mind if I give you one of hers, he said.
Then he noticed that David hadn't taken his eyes off his computer screen.
What are you looking at?
David glanced up and grinned at the seventh grader. David had been showing him the ropes around Forever Friends so that Sean could step into David's shoes if David went away to California to become a guide dog trainer. Like David, Sean was hardworking, responsible, and had an instant rapport with animals.
Come around and see, David said. I'm watching videos of service dogs in action. It's incredible.
Sean stood behind David and leaned over his shoulder. This one shows a lab golden mix calming down a veteran with PTSD. He was having a panic attack. The two boys watched the video with rapt attention.
Cool, Sean said.
I'm going to learn how to train guide dogs, David said, if I get admitted to the program.
You will. Dad says you're a shoo-in.
What'd I say? Frank asked from the doorway. The dimly lit hallway behind him could have been in any office building, but the faint, earthy smell of dogs identified the location.
That David is going to get into that guide dog training school in California?
Without a doubt, Frank said. Are you worried about that, David? David shrugged. I haven't heard back from them. They're supposed to contact me to schedule an in-person interview.
I've never seen anyone with a more intuitive connection with dogs, Frank said, or a better trainer. How long ago did you apply?
A week ago.
Give it time. I'm sure you'll hear from them soon.
Frank turned to Sean and held up a stack of papers with his right hand.
I've got what I need. Let's go. Your mother hasn't felt good all day, and I'm going to make dinner, but we have to stop by Highpointe first.
Sean reluctantly tore himself away from the video.
How long will that take?
I've got to feed and walk the dogs, David interjected. We're almost full here.
Can Sean help me? I'll bring him home when we're done. Shouldn't take more than an hour. Will that work?
Frank studied Sean.
I think that'd be fine. Do you want to stay here? He asked his stepson.
He could see by the expression on Sean's face that he did.
Sure, Sean said. If I'm going to take over for David when he's in California, I need to start training now. David does a lot around here.
Frank suppressed a smile.
That he does. Thank you, David. Why don't you and Dodger stay for dinner? The only thing I know how to cook is steak, and I have an extra one.
David's eyes lit up.
I'd love to.
He rose and motioned for Sean to follow him.
Let's get started, so we won't be late for dinner.
Mayor Alex Scanlon plucked a speck of lint from his suit coat and smoothed his impeccably cut hair as he waited at the entrance to the Highpointe College administration building. He checked his watch. The others would be there soon. He was reading email messages on his phone when someone touched the back of his shoulder. He turned to see Frank Haynes. The two men regarded each other warily.
Thank you for calling me, Alex.
Alex shrugged.
I know you still don't trust me, but I've changed.
He glanced to the ground, then looked into the distance.
I'm not the same man that got involved with Delgado and his cronies. I'm here because Maggie had a lot to do with changing my life for the better.
I agree with you on that score.
I've got a wife and stepkids that I love. And, his voice cracked, Loretta and I are expecting.
Alex brought his head up.
I hadn't heard.
He hesitated, then extended his hand.
Congratulations.
Frank took his hand.
Thank you. I'll do anything I can to show support for Maggie.
I hope we can prevent any of the negative ramifications that may come her way from all of this, Alex said. The men turned at the sound of their names. A tall, elegantly dressed woman was approaching them.
How did you find out we were meeting? Alex asked Councilwoman Tanya Holmes.
Seriously? Tanya scoffed. You think you can keep a secret in this town?
I came with Pete Fitzpatrick. He's parking the car.
I thought that Pete, as chairman of the Westbury Merchants Association, might want to be here, Frank said.
Good idea. Alex nodded his approval.
I was having a late lunch at Pete's bistro this afternoon when Pete got the call from Frank, Tanya said.
Did you tell anyone else? Frank asked.
I checked in with John at the animal hospital. Judy Young was scheduled to bring in her cat this afternoon. He said he'd mention this meeting to her.
Sheesh, Alex said. We may as well have hired a blimp to fly over town with a banner. Judy is the modern-day equivalent of the town crier.
Tanya chuckled.
I wouldn't deny that.
Here come the reinforcements, Frank said, pointing to the parking lot across from the administration building.
The three of them watched as Pete, along with the octogenarian couple Glenn Vaughn and Gloria Harper from Fairview Terraces, and Maggie's oldest and dearest friends in Westbury, Sam and Joan Torres, made their way to them.
Anyone else en route? Frank asked.
Just Councilman Tim Knudsen, Tanya said. I might have mentioned this when I ran into him at town hall. Her eyes sparkled. Judy will come as soon as she closes up celebrations.
What's the plan? Pete asked when he joined them.
Alex held up his hand as Tim Knudsen and Susan Scanlon came around the corner, followed closely by Judy.
I'm glad we're all here to support Maggie, he said.
What's all this about? Sam asked. I read an article in this morning's paper about a long-running theft of rare books from the Highpointe Library. The investigation's ongoing, but they believe most of the books were stolen more than 10 years ago.
Apparently there was an altercation in the library last night that left one man in critical condition, Pete added.
I heard this afternoon that the man in the hospital was trying to kill a librarian, Judy supplied, and that there was a professor involved, Gloria gasped. At our college library?
What does this have to do with Maggie?
Joan looked to Alex and then Susan.
Susan sighed. You know how these things go. The school will be criticized for negligence for not securing the collection before thefts occurred, and someone's going to have to take the blame.
I warned Mom.
That's ridiculous, Glenn said. Why do you think that's what's going on?
The entire board of trustees showed up about an hour ago, Susan said. The chairman of the board stormed into Mom's office, interrupting a meeting she was having with the English department, and summoned her into the boardroom with the trustees. Tim sucked air through his teeth.
That doesn't sound good.
I'd like to be our spokesperson, if that's okay, Alex said. We don't know exactly what's going on with Maggie right now, but we want the board to know that she has wide support throughout the community. We're not going to stand by and let them make her into their political scapegoat.
I agree, Susan said. Our presence when they emerge from this meeting will speak volumes. Since I'm her daughter, they won't listen to anything I have to say. Alex, as the mayor of Westbury, will be the most persuasive person to address them.
Are we all agreed? Alex asked. The group nodded.
I'd like to give them a piece of my mind if they're going after Maggie, Judy huffed. I've known most of those trustees my entire life. Their fancy jobs and expensive suits don't intimidate me.
There'll be time for that later, Alex said. Not now, all right? We don't want to make things worse for Maggie.
He held Judy's gaze.
Oh, all right. I'll keep my mouth shut.
Thank you, Alex said. Let's get in there.
The group of supporters entered the building and found Josh waiting for them outside Maggie's office.
The boardroom is down the hall, second door on the right.
Josh led the way. They lined up in the hallway outside of the boardroom. They didn't have long to wait. Seven unsmiling men and two stern-looking women filed out a few minutes later. Maggie brought up the rear. Her countenance appeared calm and unruffled, but those who knew her well could tell by the set of her shoulders that she was angry. Maggie's eyes widened as she took in the sight of her friends waiting in the hallway. Alex stepped forward and addressed the man he recognized as chairman of the board.
Good afternoon, he said. We represent a cross-section of the citizens of Westbury. We've known President Martin for years, and many of us, myself included, worked with her to uncover and repair the fraud and corruption at Town Hall that almost bankrupted Westbury. The trustees stood in steely silence.
We understand that Highpointe College is beginning to deal with its own scandals and criminal activity. We're here to show our support for President Martin and our confidence in her ability to bring the college through this challenging time.
Alex looked at each trustee in turn. You could have no better person at the helm to lead the college right now.
We're not in a position to discuss this with you, the chairman said.
He spun to Maggie and glowered at her. The set of the man's shoulders changed when he turned back to Alex.
Thank you for your concern. President Martin has the support of the trustees at this time.
He brushed past Alex and made his way to the exit. The other board members followed. When the door closed behind them, Maggie flung her arms wide.
I cannot believe you did this. Talk about a sight for sore eyes.
We all love you, Gloria said. You saved Fairview Terraces from foreclosure when you were mayor.
Glenn and I would have lost our home without your help.
We've got your back, Sam said. No one is going to dump on you.
Tears welled in Maggie's eyes as she looked at the gentle face of the first person she'd met in Westbury on that fateful evening when she'd been snowed in at the stately manor home known as Rosemont. Sam had been taking care of Rosemont for her late husband, Paul, and had opened the house for her. She'd planned to take a quick look at the place before putting it up for sale. All that changed after the first night she spent in the house that would become her home and lead her into a new life. She'd surprised her adult children when she had uprooted her life and moved to Westbury, where she'd known no one.
It had proved to be the best decision she'd ever made. Sam had become her handyman and later her confidant and encourager as she coped with Paul's infidelities and betrayals. Both she and the Windsor College trustees learned after Paul's death that he had been embezzling funds while he was president of the college. She'd settled Paul's debt to the college for the amount of his life insurance policy. Her negotiations with the Windsor trustees crowded her mind now. That situation shed light on what to expect from the trustees in her current plight.
"Was it brutal in there?" Susan asked. Maggie shrugged.
"About what I expected."
"They're concerned about covering their own behinds."
"Typical," Frank said.
"Nothing I haven't seen or dealt with before," Maggie said. "Still, you can't know how uplifting it was to see you all standing here when I walked out."
"You should have seen their faces," Pete said. "They were shocked."
"Were they going to remove you as president?" Tim asked.
"Not today," Maggie said. "But they were hinting at it."
"We're all here for you," Tanya said. "Don't forget that."
"And I couldn't be more grateful."
"There's still a lot of work."
"Maggie," Josh interrupted her, "I just took a call for you from Chief Thomas."
All eyes spun to the young man.
"Nigel Blythe died in the hospital 15 minutes ago."
Chapter 7.
Josh put his hand on the vase of tulips riding on the passenger seat to steady it as he turned the corner onto Sunday Street. He pulled to the curb and breathed a sigh of relief at the sight of the familiar car in Sunday's driveway. He should have known that Lila would have gone to check on her. He'd been trying to reach Sunday all day to no avail and had grown increasingly worried. Maggie's meeting with the trustees had run late, and he was beyond anxious to leave by the time he finally reached his car. He had almost been too impatient to stop at the supermarket, but the lot wasn't full, and he was in and out with his purchases in under 10 minutes. He wanted Sunday to know he cared, and the small fuzzy teddy bear that was sitting in the floral section, holding a book under its arm, was perfect for a librarian. Josh grabbed the flowers and the bear and dashed to Sunday's front door. He was about to knock when Lila opened it. She grinned when she saw what he held in his hands.
"Look at you. Those are lovely," she said, eyeing the tulips. "My favorite."
"I hope she'll like them."
"Of course she will. Let's put them on the kitchen table. Come in."
He followed her to the kitchen. "I also got this," he said, wiggling the bear. Do you think it's too childish?"
Lila put her arm around his shoulders and squeezed. "It's adorable, and she's going to love it."
Josh looked around. "Is she here?"
"She's upstairs taking a shower. I came over early, and she's been too upset to sleep. I made us some breakfast, and she went back to bed after she ate."
"That was awfully nice of you."
Lila raised an eyebrow at him.
"I've been very fond of this girl for a lot longer than you have. I was concerned about her. I brought my laptop and worked here all day while she slept."
"Are you staying the night?"
"No. She woke up about 30 minutes ago and said she felt much better. She asked me to wait while she took her shower, and then I was going to go home."
"Do you think she should be alone?"
"She'll be just fine alone," Sunday said, rubbing her wet hair with a towel as she entered the room.
Josh and Lila turned to her. Josh experienced the jolt he always felt when he looked at Sunday. Her hazel eyes that shone violet in daylight were dark against her damp blonde hair. Her face, unadorned by makeup, was luminous. She smiled at Josh, and his heart expanded.
"I was wondering how you were. I tried to call."
"I put my phone on silent and slept all day," Sunday said. "Lila's orders."
"I'm glad," Josh said. "Best thing you could have done."
He pointed to the vase of tulips.
"I brought you these. I wasn't sure if you'd like them or not."
"Are you kidding? I love spring flowers. They're beautiful."
She touched his elbow. That was very thoughtful of you.
Josh took the teddy bear out from under his arm and handed it to her.
I got you this, too.
Sunday laughed softly.
I thought it looked like a librarian bear. She hugged the
bear. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.